And I loved broccoli when I was a kid. But I think I love broccoli because I really like Jurassic Park. That's like, and broccoli looks like trees. So when I was a
Oh.
kid, I would just legit eat broccoli raw and I would just pretend to be a dinosaur the entire time. And so it's like I had to have been the only like 6-year-old who was just like, honestly, are you guys fucking with broccoli right now?
The energy I wanted to before. Fucking Annie's white cheddar is where it's at, dude.
I do not think that Annie's white cheddar is where it's at. I think, did you grow up with Annie's?
I did not, actually. Funny enough, Annie, I didn't. Annie's was like a, I forget who even told me about it. I think I was in high school, and we'll get into this second part later, but there was a store in a town, like in Katona, the town over, called Mrs. Green's.
Okay.
That was like the healthy
Oh,
store.
okay, yeah.
And that was really, I think, where my first
That's
Annie's,
where Annie's would be.
Yeah, that's
is
that was
that
my
like
first
this like
Annie's experience. And like
which
the
is funny
crunchy
because
healthy store in Katona, New York.
yeah, that feels like it makes sense. And it's weird too because Annie's is like it feels bougier, but it's literally, I think it's like the same cost, or it's like 20 cents more.
I think it's, yeah, it's definitely, I think that Kraft family box I got was like $3.29. And I think an Annie's family is like $4.99. I think there's definitely a dollar.
Oh, is it pretty significant?
I don't know. I mean,
I feel like the packaging looks cheaper. The Annie's packaging,
you know,
reminds me of like a store brand, like a county fair.
I bet it's recycled packaging.
I think I just have some really deep-seated hatred towards Annie's. Because as I'm hearing myself talk about, like, no, but it looks cheaper, too. It's like,
yes.
I don't know what my beef, like, did Annie's wrong me in some
yeah,
way?
Annie's,
like,
Annie's fucked your old girlfriend.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Annie's has fucked all of my old girlfriends, actually.
I mean, then,
like, texted me pictures. And it was like, how do you keep getting my number? Like,
I keep changing it because you keep haunting me.
God damn it, Annie's.
The bunny. The bunny logo.
Annie's is like, I wasn't the only one who got some white cheddar tonight. I'm like, Jesus Christ, Annie's. You're vulgar.
I feel like something would be, gross. I feel like, I think I grew up on Kraft. I feel like that's the memory that I have going into the cabinet and seeing the blue box. I don't disagree
Kraft
with
and
you.
Not. Velveeta. I feel like those are the two, like,
I think it's gonna be Kraft. My mom will text me. I'll post a story for sure. But
okay,
I made the switch specifically to white cheddar because I think how you said it's a nice change up.
Yeah.
And then I just got caught in that loop where I was like, oh, this is good. This is good. I'll change it up. And then somehow I changed it up so much and so consistently that it just became the go-to now.
So you fucked all my exes is like what you're trying to say. And that's fine. And that's a choice.
Yeah, and I made them Annie's white cheddar.
And that's a choice you can make, you know, and that's fine. I don't respect it. And I think your packaging looks cheap, but I understand.
Our packaging probably saves the environment. I think it's funny that all the stuff that is supposedly saving the environment and is like, our packaging, we've changed it to be eco-friendly. It's like, oh god, this is dog shit packaging now. Like the paper straws, I lose my mind anytime I get a paper straw.
Oh dude, even the person who came up with that like a week later was like, I fucked up.
I
like, there's no way. Like they were like, honestly, I don't know what's like, I mean how many turtles are we talking about here, you know? Like
imagine they got a bag off of it, they're so rich, and still they're like, I made the wrong call, this was not something that the world needed. The turtles, fuck them, who cares. And I love turtles too, which is, I feel kind of bad, and anytime I do see a video with them having like two straws sticking out of their cheek like a saber-toothed tiger,
yeah.
I do feel a
like
little bad.
Like a walrus turtle hybrid.
Hi.
And it's like, you're like, oh no, they're dying, but god, they look cute when they go out, don't they? I think too, it's like when the paper straw thing hit, you know, and it was like, it literally overnight, it was like, everyone needs to use paper straws, turtles are dying. And then there would be like the one person who's like, oh yeah, I mean, honestly, we could just use reusable straws. Those are better. And collectively, all of society was like, shut the fuck up, you fucking idiot. Like, I'm not going to carry a straw around. Like,
yeah, the metal straw freaks me out too, just because, yes, you wash it, blah, blah, blah. But like, I feel like one straw per the one thing you use.
Yeah.
Like, cross contain, like, you know.
There's got to be a straw that broke not, the turtle's back comment in here somewhere. No, yeah.
I wasn't, no, it was going to be, it's not on this level, but we were always told don't share needles. So I always just see that needle-shaped object that sucks the drink out a la a needle does blood. And I'm like, that's that. This straw is for this strawberry milkshake. It will go in nothing else.
I love, dude. It's like, oh, yeah, don't share needles. Like, did you guys hear that Danny hates paper straws? Well, I don't know if he hates paper straws, but he is a heroin addict.
I, during all the, like, DARE stuff growing up, needles are one of my biggest fears. So anytime,
they're terrifying.
Anytime, you know, my mom or, you know, any adult would be like, it's bad, don't do the hard drugs with the needles. I'd be like, you're good, don't worry.
Yeah, 100%.
They'd be like, oh, good, that's not. I'd be like, I'm too afraid of needles. They'd be like, ah, oh, that's, huh. We don't know if that's the end goal that we should. At least, all right, at least you're not doing them.
That's
okay.
What, yeah,
at least it's
like
not the reason, but okay.
That's how you get kids, like, away from hard drugs. You just instill needle phobias into kids. So, like, every kid that grows up just is terrified to go to the doctor, but they're also not doing drugs.
I mean, the kids that, like, were you okay with shots? Also, by the way, thanks for hanging out. This might be a record. We're almost 7 minutes in, and I didn't say, welcome back to Dinner at Your Place, Mr. Gabe Branch! One day I'm going to get to, like, the 28-minute mark with someone who's been on a couple times and be like, oh, fuck, I don't know if the people know who we're talking to yet.
It's a six-hour podcast.
They're just going to have to put it together and be like detectives of, like, all right, I recognize this voice from there. God. So, yeah, thanks for hanging out, buddy.
Yeah, of course. Glad to be here. Good to see you.
Do you want more of your pork tenderloin, mac and cheese, and broccoli?
I'll see where I'm at in like 20 minutes. I'm all just right, going to cool. chill on it for now.
Yeah, I totally tried my, like you said, broccoli with mac and cheese.
Yeah.
So would it be the Kraft? Because as we started, that was your choice.
Yeah.
So, then we just take made broccoli, like steamed or pan fried or whatever, and then throw it into the Kraft? Or would you like casserole it?
I mean, I feel like, because I wanted the Kraft mac because I fucked with it so much when I was a kid. And it was like Kraft mac and cheese and like Top Ramen were like the two things I learned how to make. That was like, I could put things into a singular pot and then use that pot to like finish a meal. That was like how I cooked when I was a kid.
Is the Top Ramen, is that that's not the cup of noodles, right?
No.
Is it like a packet with seasoning though?
Yeah, I guess I call it Top Ramen. It's like the Maruchan or whatever is the brand.
Is it like the orange?
Yeah, it's like the one that you see at the store, though, like 10 cents, and you can buy like a case for like $1.40.
There it is. So those are the two first things you learn how to cook.
Yeah. And I loved broccoli when I was a kid. But I think I love broccoli because I really like Jurassic Park. That's like, and broccoli looks like trees. So when I was a kid, I would just legit eat broccoli raw, and I would just pretend to be a dinosaur the entire time. And so it's like, I had to have been the only like 6-year-old who was just like, honestly, are you guys fucking with broccoli right now? Like,
yo, are you not pretending to be a long neck? You're doing it wrong.
Dude, are you serious? Like,
that might be the most wholesome kid thing anyone has said on this pod so far in like the year and change or whatever.
Yeah. That's adorable. I was diddled by a green bean, so I can never, I can't do those.
Yeah, the monster man.
Yeah. he was jolly. I was not. God.
Actually, yeah. Okay, while we went back there when you said, I'm going out looking cute, that comment a couple minutes ago. Do you remember that one?
Sure.
Okay. I had a dark thought of at a child funeral.
Okay. All right. It's a great premise.
What do you, like, do you still put them in a little tiny kid suit? Or like a little tiny kid tuxedo? And then are you a bad person if while paying respects at an open casket look and go, aw.
So cute.
Exactly. It still is a kid in a tux.
Like, oh, he looks like a Swerve. You know, like they just do a really bad job with the makeup.
Yeah, it's still like a...
I think, and there's going to be like one fucked up person who like sends a message and they're like, actually, it's funny you ask. I feel like there's probably not open casket kids' funerals.
That's a great point.
That feels like, because can you imagine the first person, like how fucking bold you would have to be to be like, no, this is, I think this is what people are coming for.
I don't think we should do this. This is a bad idea. Yeah. I don't think open caskets in general are a good idea. I think it's a weird... We've talked a lot about death on this show anyway.
Yeah.
So I just think it's such a weird Western...
Like, yeah, like...
Here's how they looked in their glory days. And it's like, oh, they're pumped full of so many toxins. They didn't wear fucking makeup for the last 20 years of their life. They didn't look like this at all. What are you talking about?
I've only ever been to one in my life, and it was a really long time ago. But it was like, I just remember being like, why the fuck are we doing this? Like, what? Who is this for?
It's... I was 4 years old when
I think whatever the family fucking does before, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, that's on you. That's your business. That's your grief.
Them. Exactly.
Like, I understand.
Yeah.
But like, where it's like, oh yeah, me and Kyle had math together, you know? And then you're just like, you know what I mean? Like,
when I was four, I was at my great grandmother's funeral, and I still remember, I asked my mom if I could touch her because it was an open casket.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
And she said yes, and I did, and I was like, she's so cold, we should get her a blanket.
Oh wow, that's darkly wholesome.
I right, yeah, like it so when you do an open casket, you're also, and your kid is there, you're just opening so many conversations that are about to happen for questions that you might not have the answer to.
Yeah,
you know, like, why isn't she cold? Ah, well, she's not here anymore. Where'd she go? Fucking shut up.
Yeah. Well, she's sleeping before they take her to the farm upstate. You know?
The grandma farm.
The grandma farm. The Nona farm.
Oh, man.
This is open so hot. This is open with, like...
Oh, God.
It's just been 5 minutes of the worst comments ever. I'm probably not going to have a job after this.
Fine, you will. I have a special... While we're doing like the mac and cheese stuff, I know that this is like your, you know, first thing you loved and made to, you know, how old were you also when you?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I was like definitely elementary school. Like, it's not like I was like 4 years old and like heating up a pot or something like that.
Like still like peering over counter height.
Yeah. I mean, like, I was a tall kid. Yeah. So the peering over counter height was like not very much of my life at all.
Did you get ripped on for that at all? Like, did they make fun of you for being
tall? I remember, actually, it's funny you say that. I remember specifically one comment that I got, which was equal parts clever and flattering. But at the time, when you're a kid, if anybody's poking anything at you, you know what I mean? Like,
oh yeah, you instantly,
then it's like,
go
it's
into
instantly
shell up mode. Yeah.
So I remember, so my last name is Branch and I'm very tall. And so it would be like, mm-hmm. Gabe Branch, tall like a tree, thin like a twig.
Oh.
And it's like, I mean, that's like masterclass level writing right there for these like 8-year-old kids. But at the time I was like, so like, oh, you know, shut up, guys.
Yeah. I mean, at the end of it, they're just saying you have a good physique.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. But it with some sort of malice behind it almost, you know.
Isn't it so funny too, how when you're,
I'm just 6 years old, I'm like, these jealous bitches. Yeah. Like, you know, like,
you can't see that at the time. They're just chanting it at you and you can't critically think about what is actually being said. They're just a group of kids saying it in a mocking tone, so you're like, fuck, this hurts, I'm sad. And then it will hit, you're like, oh wait, did they just, they, that really wasn't anything, huh? They just wanted my body.
Well, the, yeah, yeah,
they wanted just, my little boy body,
they wanted my my sexy slender body, and so tall it could just climb me. I think the problem is too, is that like, you can look at that when you're a kid and you're like, oh man, like they were just kind of pointing out a thing that existed. They weren't really necessarily making fun of me, but then it just carries into adulthood. 'Cause now somebody could be like, oh, you look great in that shirt. And I'm like, oh, thanks a lot. And then I'm like, actually I have a lot of anxiety and insecurity, so I know their line.
Yeah. It's all right. Well then. So it seems like you're not great at accepting compliments.
So I started therapy is basically is what I'm getting.
So is compliments a tough thing for you?
I think I just don't know how to take them. I think it's like less that I trust them. Some I don't trust. Like, some I definitely have, like, insecurities, and so somebody will say something, and I'm like, hmm. And then others I do trust. I think it's just, like, I'm, like, so concerned about having an ego and, like, being one of those kind of people that I just, like, block out all positive reinforcement to some degree.
Will you, like, reverse it almost in a sense, too, where you'll then go into self-deprecate mode so you don't even have any sense of an ego?
No, I used to, and it was, like, an old relationship where she was, like, this is, like, years ago, but it was an old relationship where she was, like, every time somebody says something, you, like, always have a self-deprecating comment, and she's, like, I know you're doing it to be funny, but you're convincing yourself that it's real. Like, you're yeah. not, like, you at a certain point don't think it's funny. You just are repeating what you think the truth is.
You're saying it out loud in a funny tone and getting laughs, but yeah. also that then reinforces your own thinking of, like, well, they're laughing, so it must be true.
Yeah, exactly.
But also they might, at the same time, might be laughing because it's so outlandish.
Totally, yeah. And I think I always tried to make it be, like, really off the wall kind of thing when I would do it. But then, yeah, it would be like if somebody was just like, oh, man, like, new girlfriend, she looks great. I'd be like, yeah, she's into bridge trolls, you know, like, and it's like, you know, I'm a pretty normal looking person, you know.
You're so a good looking, like, dude. Yeah.
So
also, I think at the same time, you inserting that shot at yourself, like, they didn't even, that's almost just like a compliment to her, you know, through yeah. you. They're not even bringing you up, like, it wasn't like, how'd you get her? She's like, hey, you have a beautiful girlfriend.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She's lovely.
Yeah, I have gotten plenty of the, how did you make this thing happen? And it's like,
and that's such a dick move.
Well, it's like, dude, it, like, you have no personality. That's why you don't have this.
She couldn't answer, you know, the riddles. That's why, yeah, exactly. She, you know.
She couldn't answer me these questions three.
I tricked her. It was just, you know, and I feel like a lot of times people don't read the room right, which is how, you know, how we just did it there. We bounced off, you know, it was fun.
Yeah, but yeah, yeah.
They'll just come way over the top to start it and be like, whoa, how'd you land that, babe, you fucking uggo? And you're like, whoa, I haven't seen you in a week or whatever. Like,
yeah, I feel like usually too,
we warm up.
That's like almost always somebody, like, projecting their own insecurities. Like, I have my own insecurities, but for the most part, they're, like, internalized. It's, like, shit that I, like, overthink about and deal with. But when somebody, like, throws something at you that's, like people say, like, backhanded compliment, it's, like, well, then it's not a compliment. You know what Dude. I mean? If there's, like, a backhanded aspect to it, it's either, like, that shirt looks great, or that shirt would look great on him. So it's, like, well, does the shirt look great, or are you just saying I look shitty? You know what I mean? Like,
I'm just being honest, you know.
Yeah.
I don't, you know.
Oh, I love, that's the fucking best.
Just being honest, but.
Yeah.
Or, you know, something like, it's like, don't you, however the sentence you're about to say, take one beat and rephrase it.
I would love to go, like, way further on the, because, like, anytime somebody, it's like when you know something racist is about to happen, where it's like, well, unpopular opinion, but I would love to take the, like, to the extreme of, like, I mean, look, I'm just being honest. You would be the first to go in this apartment in an apocalypse. You know? Like, just, like, really hit this weirdly meta level of, like, no, not just even sizing you up. I mean,
what? No, I'm just saying, like, you'd get eaten, whether it's by the zombies or us, to survive.
Yeah.
You're going first.
I would never eat a human, but I don't view you as human, so. And I'm just being honest. I'm just being honest with you.
I love you, know? You. I love living with you.
I think you're great. But I love your energy.
I don't live with a human. You're subclass.
Love your energy giving me energy upon consumption. I'm just being honest. I'm just being honest.
And it always is. Oops. Oh, my God. So,
do you get that a lot? Like, in, like, because I feel like, not to switch it and interview you, but, like, with comedy, it's like, people laugh or they don't, and then you're working on stuff and you're trying to figure it out and figure out the best thing.
Yeah.
But you're always around people who are comics, so, like, do you get the occasional person who's like, I'm just being honest, drop the bit, and then simultaneously you're like, dude, I haven't seen you make a single person laugh since the 40s.
Yeah. I get a lot
That's maybe two subjects, I guess.
No, but. Okay. So I do get a lot of drunkards that'll come up afterwards and say, like, good set, you got a joke about this, you know. Yeah, like, yeah. Someone the other day came up to me and was like, you got a joke about Chinese people. I was like, what? That, well, no, I don't. That's, no, I do not.
Yeah, actually, that's the largest demographic on the planet, so that's probably,
yeah.
You should make more jokes about everyone that aren't Chinese and then just win over the Chinese market.
Good point. And then, that's the path to success.
It's them or India. I mean, just like
pick. Dinner at your place is pro-China.
We're not free and shit over here.
So I get that, you know, I think every comic gets that. And yeah, I mean, also you'll get comedians who are a little in the bag at a show or whatever and be like, oh, here's a punchline, you know, do this differently, or yeah, here's some advice. And you're like, all right. You know, of course that there's, I can name plenty of comedians where if they do give me advice, I'm like, yes, I am taking that advice.
Totally.
Writing it in stone. And that's that. But then, of course, there will be the people who are like, you gotta do this. And you're like, all right, I'm not gonna.
Yeah.
And the worst is when...
Thanks for the tag, asshole.
Yeah, the worst is when someone does it that you like, don't... Not respect, but you're like, all right, fuck it. I'm not taking that piece of advice.
Yeah.
Whether it's, like, we'll go with the tag example. If someone does give you a tag that you don't care about, whatever, and then later, if you're on stage and it just like slips like you just say it because your brain heard it and you're like, oh, I'll try it, whatever, and it works, and you're like, God damn it.
Oh, fuck.
The worst person I know was right.
I can't even imagine that.
Yeah, it's that Onion article that feeling come would to life.
Yeah, that feeling would fuck me up, I think.
It's, oh, dude, it's, that one hasn't happened a bunch. Like once, maybe. One of the coolest was someone who I haven't seen even in like pre-pandemic.
Okay.
Was like, hey, what if you switched these words around? That was all they said. Like two sentences, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
And since then, it's like a great joke or whatever. And I feel like I haven't seen them since then. It's like, whoa. they dropped that. They're like, what if you did this? Goodbye.
Exactly.
I'm gonna make your set better for the next 6 years. Like,
yeah, it's like the ghost of joke restructuring. Yeah, just shows up clanking chains in the middle of the night.
Yeah, I mean,
heed my warning. The sentence structure isn't quite there.
You're close. You must look deeper. Yeah, so I hope you. I mean, I think he got married. I think it was one of those deals. You know, lost him to love.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah.
One of them comics that got happy.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's like always the thing. Like, oh yeah, they got married. They haven't been the same. Yeah, it kind of sounds like they've improved. You know,
dude.
Like,
did you?
They never go out anymore. Yeah, it's a real pain in the ass. We're not all spending $100 every Friday night getting blackout drunk and then ordering $60 worth of Uber Eats.
Dude, it's. That, you know, comics or not, it blows my mind though when comics will do a show, they don't get a tab for the show, and then they'll spend however much they're going to be paid in drinks for that show.
Oh, okay. So it's like, oh, you get, let's say, $40 to do a set.
Yeah.
And then,
and some, you know, most shows will be like, you get two drinks, you get a drink, food, you get. What I mean, in some places, the cool ones are like, drink as much as you want. We don't give a shit.
Oh, sick.
So some places, unfortunately, and I get it too, but they're like, hey, we can't just like give out booze.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's no drink tabs, you know, unfortunately. But it is a paid show.
Oh, that's always
that's always the like, no drinks, but it is paid.
Yeah, that's
so
fair.
It's like, that's cool. And then I will watch people go spend the pay or more at the bar.
Yeah,
on booze, and it's like, you're coming out negative.
Yeah, every time. I guess then it's like, I don't know. It's like, are you viewing the comedy as like a source of income? I guess they very obviously aren't. But I'm also going to take a shot in the dark that the people doing that are not like rolling in dough either.
Right. Well, because of those,
because they're dropping the exact same amount of money, if not more.
Exactly. And some people, it's crazy. Some people who do it are good and. Are, you know, working comics. And
oh,
it's just
yeah.
Like, oh, just save it. Just, and then you can keep going, you know. Like,
yeah.
You won't be stuck in this, like, Inception hamster wheel of.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, I mean, that's the fucking sauce.
I mean, it's just,
do you drink much? I feel like I've seen you drink like a couple times, but like Not very little.
I mean, I have always, you know, I've always been open when this question, I smoke so much weed, but I barely drink. I'll have like one, maybe two before a show. That's kind of my limit. Yeah. I haven't been drunk since 2021, maybe.
I was really hoping you were going to be like, yeah, since like Bush Jr. was in office.
I mean, same thing though with chefs in the restaurant industry. I'm sure there's plenty of crossover where you see
so much substance
talented
abuse.
People who just can't get out of their own way with whether it's booze from the bar or drugs that they're bringing in. Like,
totally, yeah. Yeah, it's a lot of people like get, they kind of get into this like sexy party chef mentality, but it's like, and like, it's not like there's not moments. I'm not going to say there's not moments when you're going to like restaurant openings, so there's like industry parties and you're like seeing all these people and stuff like that. Like, there's moments for sure, but people just end up like spiraling so hard, and then the next thing you know, you're like seeing somebody who, yeah, is like pretty like talented and stuff, but it's like, yeah, they just get fucking drunk every night, they make shitty decisions, they're like hitting on their own staff. Like, it's like, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
And which isn't to say that they maybe wouldn't have some of that shitty social behavior if they were sober, but yeah, just like all ends up spiraling.
Just, this is gonna be a really dumb question. Do restaurants have HR staff?
No. So
it's the same thing with, I always, running bit with Ryan Ellington and I, is that comedy needs an HR person.
Oh god, that would be the most underpaid, overworked person.
Underpaid and overworked. Each city, each scene though, has an HR rep.
Oh man. I would love to see like the regional rep for like the smaller states, like where there's like, you know what I mean? They get together for conferences and it's like, dude, that's fucking Dan. Like,
dude, he's the Northeast rep.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Whoa. He's got a lot of comics under his belt. You know what I mean? He represents a lot of people.
It's weird, right? That there's
only flip side is like, if you have like a, let's say you have like a big restaurant group. So whether it's the same restaurant, so let's just say like Burger King, right? If Burger King wasn't a chain, it's just your local restaurant, Burger King.
Let's go. Can we go with Graves?
Yeah, let's go with Graves.
Do they?
Let's go with the restaurant I work at to make it relevant for the podcast.
They have that one location. They have the wine bar that you're at.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the restaurant right next to it, yes?
Yeah, American Provisions, which is like bodega, coffee shop, liquor store. Like, oh. It's like, yeah, it's like kind of all the things, because they do sandwiches and salads and prepared foods.
Oh, cool. Okay.
But then sell beer, wine, liquor. Yeah, well, three technically. There's two American Provisions. One's in Dorchester, one's in Southie, and then Gray's, which is right next door.
All right, so this seems like a perfect example.
Yeah, so that's like three spaces, a pretty good amount of employees amongst all locations, but it's like, it's not quite big enough to where it, like, I'm not gonna say it necessitates HR, because like, you can make the argument that any amount of people would necessitate an HR,
but kind of silly, but I think two people, if you're a company,
could technically,
they need a third person who's neutral,
yeah, like a mediator,
yeah, basically. Exactly. So at that point, it's probably not HR, it'd be more mediation, but same concept. But anyway, continue.
So we don't, I mean, there's like policies for like certain things where it's like,
don't hit on the staff,
yeah. I mean, beyond that though, it's like X amount of managers need to be present for this thing that's gonna happen, like if somebody's getting let go or like whatever.
Smart, yeah,
yeah. So there's like stuff in place, but I would say that's like more normal. But if you had, let's say, like, you know, five or six restaurants and you're employing like over 150 people, that is a situation which is more likely to have HR, or at least it's probably not going to be, it's not on site. It's not like you can just go visit Deborah next to the prep kitchen. You know what I mean? She's just like, just chilling, you know, like,
Deborah, he washed his hands.
Yeah, exactly. He called me a piece of shit. Like, were you being a piece of shit? You know?
What? I mean, I feel like that's another thing too, is that kitchen HR would be so blunt.
Yeah, it would be fucked. Like, that's the thing. Like, that's the thing too. Like, it would be an HR nightmare, I think, like most restaurants. Like, I would say that we are not the case, and people that work there also feel that we are not a typical space because of the way we operate and because of the way we, like, conduct ourselves and handle ourselves and stuff like that.
The head chef called me a fucking dunce and told me to go outside and smoke a cigarette and never come back. Dunce. Well, what did you do? I kind of agree with the chef here. Maybe they didn't use the right words.
Yeah, yeah. Like, they would just be like, okay, so why did you come back? Like, are you going to stop being a fucking dunce? Like, are you going to, can you just, are you going to do the work? If you're going to do the work, we can talk. But if you're not, fucking go smoke a cigarette and don't come back. Like,
don't fire the guy holding knives one-on-one.
Yeah, definitely.
Have you had to fire anybody ever?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I definitely have. I've, like, suspended people. I've, like, written people up. I think there was one guy that I, like, let go because I wrote him up so many times. Because it was, like, this is years ago.
Yeah.
But, yeah. And then, I mean, I've seen, like, just in general, like, wild shit. I worked with a guy who tried to get me fired once because he said I was selling weed at the restaurant. To his credit, I was selling weed, but not at the restaurant. Nor was I ever selling weed at the restaurant. And also, in a weird twist, I sold him weed.
I knew that was going to be.
I mean, it's like the evidence of how you were calling the kettle a pot dealer. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't know what. That was like a weird.
He's selling weed. How did you know that? Well, I set up a very.
I may have solicited.
I set up a sting, an undercover sting. Yeah,
basically.
I did a stakeout for 6 weeks to make sure that he was selling the product, and then I made the buy. So you bought weed. Yeah.
Yeah. And then
yeah, I bought weed from him.
And then it was funny because then it was like it's like the owners and stuff. They're like, are you selling weed at work? And I was like, I had like a pretty high up job. And they were like, well, are you selling weed at work? I was like, absolutely not. I was like, dude, come on. I was like, I've worked for you guys for like almost 4 years.
Yeah.
Like,
that's crazy.
I was like, I'm not. And it was like pretty reputable too. Like,
yeah.
And also everyone knew I sold weed. That wasn't like, I'm like 99% sure all of my bosses and the owners knew that I sold weed. Cause I sold weed to managers of the other restaurants. Like, so it was like one of those, like, come on. But to be fair, I mean, it's like, you got to follow up on that. Like, you can't just be like, ah, well, Gabe's a good old fashioned boy. Yeah. You know, I can't see him harming even a fly. Like,
I love, you just call them on it too and be like, are you selling weed at the restaurant? No. Well, maybe you should just stop selling weed in general. Maybe you should pay me more.
Yeah.
And I'll stop selling weed.
Am I selling weed at the restaurant? No. Am I selling weed to the restaurant? Yes. Details are important. I am in this country legally, you know, like there are no parentheses around the word legally.
Oh my goodness.
But there was like one person I let go because of write-ups. I've done a lot of write-ups. I've done a lot of like disciplinary stuff. You kind of end up, not always, but you kind of end up on some level being like, I don't even want to say therapist because that implies a certain amount of work, but like you're like a guidance counselor sometimes. Because it's like, you know,
when you're letting the person go.
No, just like, I mean, I've had like what feel like legit like counselor, like borderline therapy sessions with people over the 10 years I've been doing this.
I mean, I totally can see that. I thought when you said that at first, I thought you meant in the moment, because I figure people's first reaction would be like, oh, long shot, I'm going through this, that, you know,
I'm dealing
with that, like, please don't let me go, and then you have to just hear about sad shit for 10 minutes and still at the end of it be like, you're gonna be okay, but it's not gonna be here.
Yeah. Fortunately, no. I mean, like, conversations like that, yes, but not in terms of, like, while also letting them go.
Again,
I feel like I'm such a, not a sucker, I'm just, like, I'm pretty empathetic, so if somebody was, like, doing that, I'd be like, alright, like,
do people?
I know you've slapped 6 servers' asses, but it does sound like you are struggling, you know? Like,
I was going to say, is like the restaurant hierarchy, like, who do you, if you're having, you know, bad day, want to bitch about it to somebody, do you just keep going up the ladder, if that makes sense? Or like, do you go to the hostess?
Do you mean like me or in like a general sense?
Both. But so I guess my phrasing of it, not to like,
I guess
rank
it, like, depends
how
if
important,
like,
a job is, but like, let's say how you were saying people come to you, you've dealt with therapy sessions over the 10 years.
Yeah, yeah.
Now you are a head chef of the kitchen.
Yeah.
So you are in a position of power, a position of respect.
Mm-hmm.
So people would look up to you naturally. It would make sense that if they have something big on their mind, they'll go to the head chef.
Yeah, on some level. I mean, I think it just depends on that person's like comfort or kind of who they, I guess, I hate to be like who they vibe with, but yeah, like who they have like the most energy with and towards. So generally speaking for the kitchen, like it would be me because they kind of want to, like I've had this interaction before where like people just want to be like, hey, I'm not possibly for this whole week, maybe for longer, like I'm not going to be able to give 100%. This is where I'm at. This is what's going on. I just wanted to have a conversation about it. I don't expect you to like not call me on things, but like this is where I'm at and I just wanted to let you know.
Yeah, it's cool. It's
so
a,
there's
a real team then to say, hey, I'm going to be a little, you know, pick up my slack here. I'll do it when I'm not dealing with X.
Yeah, totally. And it's like, it's good for everyone involved too. It's like, it's good for them to feel comfortable enough that they can discuss something. It's good for them to like put it out there so that if for the sake of argument, they like fuck something up, I'm not like, what the, you know, you fucking dunce, go outside and have a smoke and never come back. Like, which I love that.
It's fucking raw.
I love too that you were just like, that to me shows you've probably never worked in a restaurant.
Nope,
that you were like,
never.
You were just like, oh yeah. And then the chef would be like, you dunce? Like, that is, I wish that I'd been called a dunce. That,
oh,
like,
I, well,
that would be like so cool comparatively.
Yeah, I'm sure it's been, what is one that comes to mind you're comfortable sharing that does not still haunt you, but you look back on and can chuckle at like, nah, that's a pretty good insult.
Let's see. I mean, I got called the F word once.
See, like, that's not creative. That's just like a guy who's homophobic and not. Yeah.
Coincidentally, one of my best friends to this day. He was my boss at the time, and it's like we've like talked about it. Like we're both good on it and stuff like that. Yeah, but it's I don't know. It's like hard to quantify the behavior, I guess, because like I worked for a guy who used to like hit my hands with tongs whenever I like fuck up. And then
no fucking he went and like
I mean I'm not he didn't like full force
Catholic
like
school
fucking
nun ruler on your ass though with tongs,
but definitely like some force, not like a like little tap or whatever.
Okay, again,
yeah, yeah, exactly, exactly.
Herb Brooks coaching the U.S. Olympics team again.
Yeah, exactly. But he's like showing a guy how to do over easy eggs, like,
oh my god,
you fucking idiot, you know. Yeah, I don't know. I guess I would have to like really think about it. It's, I think it's just more than anything, it's like the intimidation that you feel from your boss doing something when you're cooking, and then like it is just an intense environment. So it's like, even myself included, like I have been better than what was done to me. I'll say that.
You jumped into the next question. Good segue. I was gonna ask for, I think the classic phrase for people who become parents is they want to just be a little bit better than what their parents were, or work on the things that weren't there, so to speak.
Yeah.
Is that sort of the same mindset in the kitchen as well? Because all chefs have come up through such a gauntlet of insults that when you finally get there, you're like, all right, I'm just going to try my best to not scream at this 22-year-old, 36, whatever, however old they may be. I'm going to try to not call them a donkey.
I think so. There's like the two ways.
Or is it when you get there, are you like, now's my turn to call them donkeys?
No, dude, 100%. 100%. That's the thing. Like, it really, it's just a total fucking fork in the road, and some people go one way and some people go the other. Yeah. Like, because that's what I always think is interesting, is when you like see the way people behave or act, you're like, you're just, I mean, I feel like therapy and counseling keeps coming up, but it's like, you're just repeating the cycle that was done to you.
Yeah, well, that's why I asked.
Maybe
that,
slightly differently or whatever.
Yeah, you're on that hamster wheel again.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, my thing is like, I definitely like have moments in general where I get pretty serious and pretty firm. I'm not like above that. But like my thing now is like, the instinct, frankly, and I think this is anybody doing anything. If you know how to do something and you see someone doing it wrong, despite showing them multiple ways, your first instinct is to be like, you are a fucking idiot. Like, yeah. I literally have shown you exactly how to do this step by step by step. And you're not even like trying to get better at the way I showed you. You're just choosing to do it the wrong way. See, so that, your instinct.
Is that the perception that they're choosing to do it the wrong way? Or is it just hasn't clicked yet or maybe forgotten?
Some people are choosing.
I was going to say, I think it could go one way or the other. You know, it depends on that person, how you've said about a couple of things.
Yeah.
They might be like stubborn and okay. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah. No, you're good. Yeah. Some people I think definitely are choosing because they've convinced themselves.
It's the right way.
Well, no, but this is a better way that works better for me. And it's like, I don't know. I feel like a lot of that stuff with cooking is like any other creative thing, like whether it's like writing a joke or like painting or something. So if it's like, okay, you're like, oh, I want to write a 5-minute set. It's like, well, write a joke first. And then if you're like, oh, well, I'm going to write a screenplay. And it's like, you haven't even written a paragraph before. You know what I mean? Like, and then if somebody is like,
start with scrambled eggs.
Oh, start. Yeah, exactly. It's like, oh, we'll start with this. And then they're like, yeah, I did that twice and it didn't really work for me. And it's like, well, this is how it works. Like, this is literally how it works. There's actually like not really like there are certain things in life, I think. And it's like so tough for people to be like, there's actually not some like different path you can take. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you can't be a master chef and then also not know how to make an omelet. Like, the two things don't.
Yes. Okay. Because you got to know the basics to break them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess like my thing in terms of like getting upset and getting angry as a chef, which does happen and which I do, sure, is to either like, I either feel like I repeat two things pretty frequently, one of which is, I understand why you did that, but that isn't how we do things.
Okay. That's a good, I think that's a good statement. That feels like
reasonable.
Yeah, you're acknowledging their decision while still trying to reinforce the rules of your kitchen.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good.
Or,
you fucking donkey.
Yeah. You dunce. Or like the flip side, I'll be like, and again, I'm not perfect every time. I definitely have moments where I'm not cool. But, or I'll be like, this issue has come up X amount of times. Can you understand how that's problematic for me?
Good. Yeah. Okay.
Those are both
good communicating sentences instead of being pointed or, you know, directive at their intelligence, whatever you want to call it. Those are both good I feel statements.
Yeah, or I'll throw in, especially if I'm like really, and this frankly, it's so funny because it's like, I think it is a good way to communicate, but I say this if I'm like genuinely super fucking pissed off, I'll like point something out like, I've told you a few times to keep this clean and to put it back in the same place. And every time that you do it, you're not doing it. Does it feel like a reasonable ask to expect things to be clean and back where they belong? So like to throw in like, is this a reasonable ask? That's like, if I say that, I'm internally losing my fucking
mind.
Yeah, like, yeah. No, exactly, dude. That's the thing. It's more effective communication.
It totally
and
is.
And it's also like, it's, and I'm not saying this because I'm doing it to be manipulative. It's not the case. But like communicating like that, but with a tone of seriousness, is way fucking more like, I'm not mad, I'm disappointed.
Yeah.
And that fucking hurts way more.
And then,
I don't want to hurt. I'm just saying, like, I want to make sure they understand, like, absolutely, why this is important.
And I feel like the times when you do get to blow up, because I'm kind of the same, I really rarely, like, yell at someone. I'll yell about dumb things. I've been called dramatic. And that's normally for, like, humor. You know, whenever, like, shit hits the fan, I'll normally be like, okay, let's have a conversation about this, X, Y, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And I found that when the times I do have gotten angry enough and like yelled at someone or directed the anger,
you fucking dunce, like,
yeah, in so many words,
yeah,
that those moments are actually when it hits at, like, equal, like, because it's not constant. It's not.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just like, oh, he's angry. And it's like, oh, shit, he's actually pretty pissed off.
Yeah, totally. I think it's fun. It's funny because I guess I've never thought of it this way until now. But it's like, because I also am somebody who, like, I definitely get upset, like, whether it's like a friendship, a personal relationship, like work, whatever. I definitely get upset, but it's like pretty infrequent that I get to a point where it's like very obvious that I'm like incredibly angry. And not that it makes it better to get that way, but everybody eventually gets super angry. But it's like, it does make it much more impactful.
That's when it's
like,
impactful.
When it's like, okay, yes. This clearly has struck a nerve, you know, impactful, like this word, clearly, yeah, is a huge issue for, yeah, this person.
So if you're an empathetic person, how you're saying before, that's why people are coming to you. Have you found yourself at times pushing down the anger you feel about a situation because of that empathy towards a person? And if so, are you just bottling it up, or are you then processing it and being like, I did this for the sake of ease?
I am a huge, huge, huge believer and advocate that, like, two things can be true at the exact same time. So it's like,
that's my mom said that on her, like,
oh, really?
On her episode too. Yeah, she's, it's a big phrase for her as well.
Oh,
yeah.
Your mom's so cool. I love your mom. I love your mom.
I told her, she texted me the other day and was like, how's Gabe?
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. She's so sweet.
Yeah.
She's so sweet.
Yeah, it's a big thing for her, is two things can be true at once.
Yeah, two things can be true. You know, it's like, okay, so like, for instance, let's say you're in like a toxic relationship. Like, you definitely know that like what's going on is unhealthy, whether this person is like betraying your trust or like putting you down, or their own behaviors are dragging you down. And like that, especially if you're like dating somebody who has like severe depression, for example, like that can make it tough. Man. Like, and it doesn't have to be a relationship, just like a friendship or anything. It's like, you can and do really, really love this person a lot, and you're going to do all the things that you can to the best of your abilities to like make things better for this person, right, whether it's finding them resources or having conversations or whatever. But then you can also hit a point where this has impacted you so greatly that it's like, yeah, this is now not good for me.
Your own treads like, fall off, so to speak.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so it's like, and I personally have had relationships like that where it's like, okay, this, like, I have love for this person, but all of these things made me miserable. And so I still love this person and hope that they are well and life is good to them.
It's the hardest breakup.
But yeah, no, dude, it's the worst.
It's the hardest breakup where it's like, it's two puzzle pieces that almost fit together.
Yeah, that
they're so close.
Or like they do, but the rest of the puzzle doesn't work because one piece is supposed to be in a corner and the other is supposed to be somewhere else.
It's like a little raised up, or say, it's not perfectly flush. Exactly. It's and you're just trying so long to just file it down or whatever it may be to make those two pieces fit.
Yeah.
And it just can't be.
So I think in terms of empathy, I think that people have accountability, and I think that two things can be true, and that you should generally give people the benefit of the doubt and like be mindful of things. But like simultaneously, there are people that like I don't even really know personally, like in my actual life, that well, but I know enough things about them from people around me that I trust and love to where I'm like, I don't fuck with this person. Like, if this person tried to like engage me in some way or something, I'd be like, no, I'm good. Like, I don't need you in any way, shape, or form in my life. So
similarly, I had someone up to be a guest and took a screenshot and was sent it to a mutual who like this person followed and was like, do you know this person? I asked them to be on the pod, you know, curious about their story. And they were like, oh, they kind of give me the creeps and said other stuff. But at that sentence, I was like, cool. That's that. Don't. It's the end of that road. I don't need to.
Totally. And it's like, I don't know, man. Shit like that's so tricky because it's like, I think people are like worthy and deserving of like redemption on some level. But it's then the flip side. It's like, well, Do you what, 14 chances in, you know?
Yeah, do you get that redemption with me after?
Yeah. It's like the saying isn't 38th times the charm, you know?
I also have another reason why Annie's is so beloved.
Oh, yeah, let's get back to the mac and cheese. Let's talk about your wrong opinion, actually. I feel like we haven't spent enough time on that.
We'll wrap it on my wrong opinion. We'll come full circle. I told you about Mrs. Green's. And
that's the health food store.
Yeah. And the coolest part about it was that it was in this little row of other stores, little, you know, shopping centers.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And there was a door in the back that led to the roof of Mrs. Green's and the other shop, you know, for maintenance people.
Oh, but so it's roof access. It's not for you.
Oh, it's not for us at all. But okay. When that door is never locked, it's obviously for the people who know about it.
Totally.
So I genuinely think that part of my love for white cheddar mac and cheese is because of the nights spent on top of the Mrs. Green's roof, looking over Katona, the sky, you know, quote unquote skyline, you know, the roofs of Katona. You know, it's a small little hamlet, a little town. I mean, I did it in the winter a couple times where there were Christmas lights hung up. It was just like a cool, debaucherous teenager thing.
Yeah. I mean, that makes sense.
That
it makes sense that you could like justify enjoying something so bad because you're like reflecting on it and you're like, it's not just that I love how bad Annie's mac and cheese is, like that's not the whole thing. It's that this bad taste is tied to a good memory.
Yeah, I mean,
you're like reflecting on the one good moment in a bad relationship, you know, and you're like, all these things around it are terrible, but I remember that time we spent on the roof, and I'll always remember that time we spent on the roof as I slowly choked down my white cheddar mac and cheese.
So I'm in a toxic relationship, you're saying, need to break up with mac and cheese, Annie's white cheddar, despite the fact that two things can be true at once.
Yeah, I think two things can be true, but not if one of them is wrong. Because then two things aren't true.
When was you know, last time you even had white cheddar Annie's?
I don't know. I actually don't even think I've ever had white cheddar
Annie's. Oh my God, Gabe Branch.
All right, how about that? Can we meet in the middle?
What would even be in the middle then?
What do you think about the Velveeta?
Oh, is that... See, so... All right.
I feel like that bridges a gap. Because like the kids who only like Velveeta are psychotic. The kids who grew up on Kraft, that's like pretty normal. The kids who grew up on Annie's, that's like a different tax bracket.
For an hour conversation, I was under the impression that you've at least tasted the white cheddar Annie's.
I think I've had like white cheddar Kraft.
Yeah, no, that's...
But I've had regular Annie's, and I think regular Annie's is an inferior product.
The white cheddar Kraft, the powder, is Robert's jizz from the massage parlors.
Yeah, that's why I like it. It reminds me of my youth in the green room. That's why I'm like, yeah, it's fine, you know.
Uncle Robert Kraft.
Yeah, I don't love it, but like once a year at Christmas, I'll be reminded of it. Like,
shit. Wait, no, you asked a question.
Oh, Velveeta, have you?
Yeah,
had it?
I.
The nuclear cheese.
I really don't know if. See, in my mind, the, you know, like there's the Kmart, Walmart, Target.
Yeah.
For me, it's like Kmart's the Velveeta, Walmart is Kraft, and then Target is Annie's white cheddar.
Whoa, is Kmart below Walmart?
Yeah, that's what I thought it was.
Right? Oh, really?
I mean, Kmart, there's the classic joke that a bunch of comedians have, but like Kmart looks as if it's in the act of closing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah.
There's, you know, nothing on the shelves. There's, you know, that's half true. The lights
yeah,
are
they
off.
They filmed The Last of Us at Kmart, but didn't modify it in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah,
like
exactly that. Yeah, they were doing location scouts looking for a, you know, apocalyptic pharmacy that like, had some stuff but not, you know, fully stocked. And they walked into just a Kmart and they're like, oh, this is perfect.
They're like, can you shut this down to rent it out? They're like, we don't have to shut it down. Nobody's coming in here. Like, you can just film.
How much do you want to, you know, to rent out the space? I don't know, like $20.
Yeah.
What do you mean? I don't know. What do you got on you? What's in your pockets right now?
Yeah, I don't know. Why don't you just, like, buy two candy bars when you check out? Like...
All right, buddy. What's the menu for Gray's right now? What's as we end winter and near spring? Do you have any creative things you want to tackle?
Yeah, I think I want to change up a couple plates. I want to get some more vegetables on. Right now, it's like kind of fish heavy. Like there's like beer battered haddock. There's a tuna tartare. We just ran like a smoked trout spread as a special, and then we have a seared steelhead trout, which is it's like closer to salmon. Like it's a trout, but
spread like of the cream cheese consistency.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like nice. a pate.
Nice. So you want to ditch the fish, more veggies, brighter for the spring as the sun comes back out?
Yeah, I guess like as we get into spring, it'll definitely be more like a little bit more vegetable and like fruit forward. Right now it's like, you know, it's that time of the year. It's cold. Like you want just things that are like a little more warming and comforting and stuff like that. Yeah, exactly. So, but the menu's in a good place. The restaurant itself is just getting busier and busier, which is great.
Love that. I was gonna say, what's one ingredient? We can wrap on this too. We'll go just hang out as normal friends after this. choked on Kraft. Annie's would never. what was one?
Annie's is cheating on you, dude. Like, you just live in your own fucking world. Like, we all see it, you know. And you're just like, no, I'm like Annie really loves me. And it's like, yeah, but you know, two things can be true.
What's one ingredient you got to work with recently that you were happy, like, you know, excited about, haven't worked with in a while, or it was new?
I don't know that I would. Okay, so because I can't just be like the ingredient, because the ingredient is kind of silly. So I made some cream spinach, but hold on. So recently I went to New York for like a day and a half and just ate at a bunch of restaurants with my bosses and the general manager. It was like an R&D trip. It's a fun field trip. Yeah, it was great. It was great. It was good. It's good to get out of your own like market and eat a bunch of good food and see how other people do things. But
totally agree.
I was like really curious and inspired when I was eating there, because I was like kind of for no reason, I was like eating something that had flavors of dashi. So dashi is at its like root effectively is like dried seaweed, dried fish, and dried mushrooms, like all brought together to make a broth that you use as not always, but generally it's like a ramen base.
Yeah, it sounds pretty rich, so like it that, would be for a soup that sticks to your bones.
Exactly, yeah. So it's like you can use it for a lot of things, but predominantly use it as an addition to a ramen base. And so I was like eating all this food and I was like, oh man, I would kind of like to do like this fish with cream spinach. But I was like, I wonder if this would work. And so instead of using just like water and making it like a broth, I took all the ingredients in the base of making a dashi, but with cream. And then used that to cream spinach. So it's like, it's blended really aggressively. So it's kind of aerated. So it eats really light. But it just tastes like super fishy and rich.
It has a ton of flavor to it though.
Yeah. It's like, it's crazy when you eat it. It's like actually fucking insane how delicious it is. And then just finished with a little bit of vinegar. So it's still like got some bite.
See, you have such an incredible talent. You specifically, not like you chefs, you specifically have an incredible talent of taking, and you've said it in the first episode, you've told me at the restaurant in texts, you like taking the like more basic ingredients, I guess, like a carrot or, spinach or whatever.
Yeah.
And letting that do the talking and letting that shine instead of like, here's a $600 cut of meat that I've just put salt on and cooked properly, which is still very impressive. Don't get me wrong.
Which is awesome. Yeah. And there's value in that.
But I think what I always find impressive with you, how you just said, you're like, I had some cream spinach lately. Hold on though.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
but and then, wait, there's more.
Right. And then you elevated this bland, it's not my favorite.
No, yeah, cream spinach kind of sucks.
Yeah, and
spinach artichoke dip is awesome.
I love spinach artichoke dick.
Yeah, that, honestly, I would have a much better childhood memory if it was just some good old spinach artichoke dick.
So I just find that impressive that I feel like, as at least things I've seen on videos or shows, what they, you know, try to portray at least is that as chefs continue to grow in their craft, they continue to get access to more expensive, more exotic, rare materials or ingredients, whatever should you call it. But I feel like every time that you tell me about a meal you're excited about that you made or like coming up, it's always just stuff you can go find yourself.
Yeah, it's like, I don't know. I know that there's like a word for it or whatever, but yeah, I think it's that kind of thing where it's like you hit a certain point and you're like so hyper invested into like this obscure ingredient or the most expensive product that you can get or like the craziest like technique that you can use. And then once you push past that point, then you slowly just end up back where you started and you're just like, now you have all this knowledge, all these abilities, these ways to like infuse flavors. And you're like, yeah, carrots are good, huh? You know, yeah. Like you're just like, oh yeah, that's cool. Like, you know what else is good? I just like steak and a sauce like that. And that's it. And that's the whole fucking plate. Like,
is a part of you trying to make vegetables taste better? So if a 6-year-old comes into Gray's pretending to be a dinosaur,
you know what?
Then get a little inspiration of like, maybe I'm a chef dinosaur.
yeah. You know, maybe on some level. And I do really like kids a lot. So I'm always really stoked when there's kids in the restaurant and I can like find something that we already have or like make something that they would like. Like, I get really stoked if there's like a 4 or 5 year old in the restaurant and I make them a grilled cheese. That's like, and I've like cut the crust off them before too. I'll like ask, you know, like, do they want the crust cut off?
Adorable.
Like, yeah, I love it.
Because you guys don't have a kids menu.
No. I mean, like, no, we're a fucking natural wine bar. We're a 34-seat natural wine bar. Like,
what's your kids menu at Gray's Hall? Gabe's Kids Corner.
I mean, currently what we do is we'll either make them like a kid's burger, so just meat, cheese, and
the
bun.
Smash burger without
just like well done meat, cheese, bun. That's like basically when people ask, like, what can my kid eat? We open with that, but then from there, like, I'll be like, okay, like, well, I don't know, like, what are they eating? You know, like, where are they at?
That's
like,
so fucking considerate of you.
Well, because it's like, you know, like, kids are always like on different state. Like, some kids are fucking wild, dude. Yeah. I gave a 3-year-old like a huge spoon of smoked salmon roe because they tried a little bit on like one of the dishes. This was months ago. It's like a pate that we topped with that, and they were so geeked that I was like, I'm kind of curious. I looked at their parents. I was like, are you guys cool with this? They're like, we're stoked. And I gave them like a huge thing of smoked salmon roe and just watched this kid go to town on it.
It's like an ice cream pop.
No, but it was like, I think it was like the texture of it, you know, like the popping bubbles kind of thing.
Yeah, the jelly.
But it's like, that's like the fishiest thing on the planet, you know?
Oh, yeah. It's crazy.
So that's the thing, too. It's like fun for me. It's like, I mean, I like doing that too, and that's who I am, but it's also fun for me because then I get to like watch a kid eat
a giant spoonful of salmon roe.
Yeah, effectively like $14 worth of salmon roe that I gave him for free, you know, but I'm just like sitting there just like, oh yeah, this is awesome. This is good for me.
And I mean, that's a memory for them too.
Yeah.
And it's just crazy though that that's not something that most chefs do, right? They're not gonna go out to the table, ask the kid or the parents, like, where the child is in their eating stage, what they like. Because then you can just take, I'm sure you've done this, you've taken ingredients from X, Y, and Z meal and been like, here, this is a child's meal of things that we had around. It's not on the menu, but this is what I whipped up for your kid.
Yeah, because we're attached to, like you were saying, American Provisions.
Yeah.
And so they have different things than we do. And so, like, if it's, like, a really little kid, I'll just, like, go downstairs and grab some stuff from their cooler and just make, like, a fruit plate.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, okay, it's not the norm at all, but it's also, it's totally dependent on the space, you know? Like, if I was cooking and working and expediting at a 200 seat restaurant and I'm one of six people cooking and I have to be there constantly, then I don't have the time to do that.
Good point.
Here, it's 34 seats. It's an open kitchen. So if a family sits down, I can see that a family sat. I don't have to like go through some swinging double doors to be like, what's going on in the restaurant?
Prairie dog your head out.
yeah, exactly. So it's different. It's different. And in the past, definitely, I would say I'm more accommodating than most, regardless of scale of restaurant. But I don't know. Everybody's got their thing, you know? Some chefs, like, make food for kids and make it a point to make time for that. Some chefs fuck their staff, you know? Like, it's you know, like a lot of things. There's a fork in the road, and some of us go down the making food for kids, and some of us go down fucking kids. Like, you know? different strokes, sometimes literally. That's like all it is, you know.
You are very funny, very talented, very kind, and I hope anyone who is listening goes to Gray's because they will have the best meal of their life.
Oh, I appreciate you. You're very sweet.
Treated me and my mother that night like royalty, and you clearly treat anyone who walks through those doors like royalty, whether you know them or not. So Gray's Hall in Southie. That's where you're at.
Yep.
Not on Mondays.
Nope. Closed Mondays. We're doing art shows once a month on Sundays. You'd have to check like the Instagram for that. Dollar Oysters on Tuesdays, and I'm there Tuesday through Saturday. I am 6'4". It is very obvious if I'm there or not.
All right. I'll put the Instagram again for Gray's as well as Gabe Branch, which is not Mike Giant.
Yep.
Everybody loves follow that. Dinner at your place, and thanks for listening. Goodbye, guys.
Bye bye.